Hey there, Josh Powers with Quixel. As we continue exploring the Mixer Mask Stack, we're going to dive into the pattern component, which is one of the most powerful ways to generate procedural height masks for tiling textures. So let's get started. To add a pattern, simply click on the Add Mask Component button here, and then select Pattern. With the pattern component, we have four choices: square, circle, checker, and gradient. However, even though there are four choices from the menu, they all function under the same component, so we're able to freely change between all four options at any point by using this dropdown at the top of the component. Let's take a moment to look over the different settings inside the square pattern selection, which has quite a few options for us. The first two sliders will control the X and Y repeat. So if we wanted a floor tile, we'd probably want these to stay pretty even. But if we wanted something more brick-like, we would probably go ahead and repeat one more than the other. The next two sliders are spacing. Spacing determines how much space exists between each instance of the square. So as we adjust the X spacing here, we'll see that the gap will grow wider or become more narrow depending on the value we give it. The larger the value, the wider the space. I would also like to note that both the spacing sliders as well as the repeat sliders do cap out at a preset limit. However, if we want to have more range, we can simply type in a numerical value to increase this amount. Once we've typed in a new value, the slider's new cap will be that value. The offset slider lets us offset the tiling of the pattern. This is a very useful way to give us that staggered look that we often see on brick walls. We can also switch the offset to use a vertical method. Next, we have a few jitter options that will add a lot of depth and character to the mask. Let's say we wanted to make a brick wall that was a little bit older and worn down, and perhaps not very well constructed. Brightness jitter will let us apply random grayscale values to each square in the pattern to give us varying heights in the mask. The amount slider will determine how dark we're willing to allow any one square to go. The default setting of 1 will allow some bricks to go fully black. However, as we slowly pull back on the slider, the darker values start to brighten, giving us less height variation between each square. This is particularly nice because even newer, more well-constructed brick walls will still have some variation between each brick, and this is a good way to add that subtle depth of realism that will really pop when light hits the surface at the right angle. Threshold will let us control how many instances are affected by this. So as we pull the slider up, we'll see more and more squares popping to the default white value of the pattern. Setting the value to 1 effectively turns off the jitter entirely, whereas setting it to 0 will allow every square in the pattern to be assigned a random grayscale value. And then random seed will randomize both the grayscale values as well as which squares are affected by the threshold value. So we can play around with the slider until we find something we're happy with. In addition to the brightness jitter, we also have gradient jitter. This setting will apply a gradient overlay to each instance of the square, giving the square more of a sloped or angled appearance. Gradient jitter also has an amount slider, but the major difference here is that it has two handles to adjust, giving us a minimum and maximum option to play with. The wider apart these handles, the more variety we'll see in the steepness of the slope being applied. If we bring the sliders together, the slope steepness will be applied the same on each square. And if we turn off brightness jitter and then hold down shift to drag both of these handles at the same time, we can see that the same intensity of slope is being applied to each instance of the brick, even though they're all at different angles. Which leads us to our next setting, angle. Angle also has a two-handle slider, letting us specify a minimum and maximum value. Setting this slider at 0 and 1 will allow a 360-degree rotation to be randomly applied to each instance. Whereas if we squeeze the sliders together, the rotation will be the same for every instance. Threshold functions the exact same way as it does on brightness jitter. The higher we pull the slider, the fewer instances will be affected by the gradient jitter. And likewise with random seed, it will randomize the amount and rotation of the gradient based on the settings assigned. Size jitter will allow us to randomly scale each instance. The amount will let us determine how small we're willing to allow any given square to be. Threshold, as before, will gradually reduce the frequency that the effect is applied. And then random seed will randomize the effect on each instance of the square. The bevel settings will let us give the edges of the squares a nice slope to them so that they don't feel so razor sharp, which will really help with the normal map information. Bevel Curve operates the same way Gradient Remap's Curve Slider operates. If we drag the curve down to negative 1, we get this concave type slope. Whereas if we drag it all the way up to 1, we get more rounded edges that bulge outward. And then finally we have cutout. As we increase the cutout amount, we'll see individual instances of the squares being fully removed. This is a great way to make it look as if some bricks had been damaged and fallen out over the years. And then of course, random seed will randomly apply that cutout amount to the pattern instances. Next, let's take a look at some other pattern types in the list. Circle, as it sounds, gives us a circular pattern that can be repeated on both the X and Y axes, as well as being able to adjust the spacing, and then also the offset. Checker gives us a black and white square pattern. The settings we can adjust are repeat X and Y, as well as offset. It's worth mentioning that due to the nature of pattern, breaking the tileability of the pattern is possible depending on your settings. If you keep the repeat values both set to even numbers, it'll tile normally. However, if you're using odd values, we might see some tiling issues. Likewise, adjusting the offset might break tiling. However, by playing with both the repeat and offset, you can use that to your advantage to come up with some pretty cool patterns. Then lastly, we have gradient. Gradient acts very similar to the position gradient component. However, it doesn't take into account any underlying mesh normal or height data, and rather it operates in a 2D space. This makes it useful for surface and tiling textures, but it's less than ideal for the numerous UV islands that you'll have on a 3D mesh. Since it doesn't take any of the mix's other layers into account, using the gradient pattern component is cheaper to render, so be sure to use that component if you don't need the extra settings that come with position gradient. Alright, now that we've gone through the different settings of the pattern component, let's take a look at how we can put this to some good use. Let's go ahead and give the solid layer here a mass stack. We're going to create some damaged concrete floor tiles, so the first thing we're going to do is throw on a square pattern. Let's play with the X and Y repeats a little bit to give us a few extra tiles. 6 is looking pretty good, so we'll go ahead and reduce the spacing of both X and Y to pull back on the grout lines between each of the tiles here. And we'll leave offset alone. Alright, let's activate the brightness jitter and we'll play with the slider here until we're happy with the results. And we'll do the same for random seed. Okay, let's give these tiles some slopes to add more of the worn and destroyed look to them by activating gradient jitter. I'm going to set the min and max values of both amount and angle to be from 0 to 1, so that we can randomize the full range of the slopes as well as the direction. Then we'll adjust the seed until we find a value we're happy with. And then finally, we'll go to the cutout dropdown and play with the settings to randomly remove a few of the tiles altogether. Okay, the edges of the tiles are feeling a bit too sharp, so we can soften them up just a tad by applying a low-strength Gaussian blur. Now, the tiles already have some nice slopes and brightness variations, but we can take this a bit further by adding a Purlin noise component on top of this. The first thing we'll do is set it to multiply, and then we'll play with a few of the settings, making sure to keep the amplitude, which effectively controls the intensity of the mask, on the lower side. That will ensure that the noise itself will not be too heavy in contrast. We'll also lower the frequency a little bit to keep the details of the noise fairly broad, and then we'll leave the other settings alone. If we go back to PBR mode, we can toggle the mask layer on and off to see how it's not only lowering the overall height to our tiles, but it's adding very subtle irregularities across them, which will not only help add some more character to them, but help with the final texturing process as well. Alright, because this is supposed to look a bit more weathered and worn down, like it belongs in a post-apocalyptic world, we need to add some damage to the tiles. This is a perfect place to use the map component. We'll go ahead and select Library Asset from the dropdown, and then we'll just go into the Megascans library and search for a damaged concrete surface. Using the displacement maps of surfaces is a fantastic way to incorporate mass detail like this, so let's go ahead and change the dropdown to displacement. After making a few adjustments to the range sliders at the bottom of the component, we'll change the blend mode setting to min and then drop the opacity down a little. And if we go back to PBR mode, we can see that some of the chunks were removed from the tiles, and this will help them feel a little bit more weathered. But these chunks alone feel a bit weird, so let's add some cracks next. We'll do the same thing as before. We'll add a map component, use the library asset option, and choose a nice cracked megascan surface like this one here. We'll once again change the texture source to displacement, and then we'll play with the range sliders a little bit. And then we'll set the layer to multiply as well as reduce the opacity some. Now if we go back into render mode, we can see that both of the chunks and the cracks spread across the floor tiles. And as we add solid layers and megascan surfaces using a combination of blend settings and mask stacks, we can quickly create a damaged concrete tile floor non-destructively. I hope this video gave you a better understanding of the pattern components inside Mixer's mask stack, and that it'll help you create textures faster than ever. Thanks so much for watching, and we'll see you in the next video.